Most of the literature I teach is from the 20th century, and so in this short video I'm going to try to demystify some of the basic concepts underlying modernism and postmodernism. You probably know what fads are, such as disco music, Rubik's cubes, and bubble tea. Modernism and postmodernism might be explained as super fads. They're artistic attitudes or systems which affect art, music, literature, architecture, and philosophy in their own time periods. And just as fads are only popular with some people, and you or your parents might not have played with Rubik's cubes, modernism and postmodernism also generally describe intellectual movements in Europe and North America. When I talk about these schools or periods, remember that of course they don't affect everyone. It's a valid criticism of these movements that they are elitist. But whether we like it or not, elites have produced our most prominent art and schools of thought. One way of defining periods of Western intellectual history is to ask, what is truth? If we lived in medieval Europe, the answer was generally, whatever is revealed by God that allows us to understand our world. If we lived in the early modern age, or what's called the Enlightenment or scientific period, we might say that truth is primarily whatever we can derive from observation or reason. That doesn't mean people stopped going to church in 1800, but that this was the majority intellectual discourse of Europe. By the 19th century, there are also two artistic and literary trends worth mentioning, that of Romanticism and Realism. Romanticism says that truth is found in the human heart and in feelings. Realism argues that attention to precise detail and accuracy will convey truth. These are all different schools, but what they have in common is the assumption that truth is knowable. We just have to get to it. By the beginning of the 20th century, many artists and thinkers are not so optimistic about man, and not so sure that we can get to the truth. Darwin argues that man might not be divinely special. Freud argues that man isn't always ruled by reason, but is affected by our subconscious desires. Henri Bergson argues that our memories aren't reliable and can be altered by subsequent experiences. Werner Heisenberg argues that even physical matter isn't necessarily stable. Modern war suggests that maybe our traditional values aren't good ones. Yes, I'm simplifying, but these are influences which give birth to modernism, which is an artistic mode and philosophy which argues that A, we can't be sure what truth is because our experience of reality is subjective and individual, and B, traditional modes of art are not only boring, but discredited by history. The cry of modernism is, make it new. Some characteristics of modernism are experimentation. Writers begin to play with stream of consciousness narration, or writing which breaks the linear flow of time, or writing which contradicts itself or is unreliable. The assumption is that the narrator and all the characters also have a flawed perception of truth. Painters do the same by rejecting the idea of a photograph-like representation of objects, because we all see things differently. And so painting becomes more subjective, abstract, and symbolic, as a way of representing the artist's impressions or perceptions of truth. Modernism also changes sculpture, dance, music, and architecture, where traditional forms of representation are rejected in order to make it new. The tendency of modernism, and one of the reasons it's often disliked by the public, is that this trend continues to the point that for many people it becomes so individualized and symbolically difficult that it's inaccessible. What do paint splotches mean? How can people find cold concrete angles comfortable or useful? How can a stage play about garbage be enjoyable? Postmodernism is perhaps both a continuation of modernism and a reaction against it. Philosophically, postmodernism rejects the idea of a unified truth at all, instead arguing that there are multiple and often temporary truths. Some of these truths are called constructs. Language, culture, gender, science, ethics. Many postmodernists would say these things don't objectively exist. They're just useful inventions that societies use as necessary. As well, some constructs are not good things and are only imposed by those with power, usually Europeans and males. This sounds confusing or even depressing, but to a postmodernist, this smorgasbord of truths and ideas makes the world richer and more fun. Artistically, if originality is just a European construct of power, and our divisions between Beethoven and the Spice Girls is an artificial one of power, well then the artist is free to mix together anything. Often postmodern literature combines fiction and nonfiction, combines different stories and narrators, admits it is a text, or may even refuse to have an ending. You should also know the word pastiche, which refers to this mixing together of different topics or styles. In one of the arguably first postmodern songs, the Beatles combine Eastern and Western music, and architecture can do the same, and food can do the same. Just like modernism, not everyone likes postmodernism, and some believe it is fake or at least unnecessarily hard. There are valid scholarly criticisms that it's parasitical and that it reuses older materials without inventing much new. As a philosophy, the idea that reality is just multiple perceptions is not accepted by everyone. Scientists don't tend to agree that their findings are merely unstable viewpoints corrupted by Eurocentric values. There are also criticisms of the social justice advocacy elements, which connect to postmodern philosophies. No one fully understands postmodernism because we're still in it, and we don't know what's coming after postmodernism, or if anything. Although some theorists believe that just as the medievals did not place man at the center of the world, the way the humanists did, post-humanism also will not see man as the most important subject. But we haven't turned into robots yet, and as I said at the beginning, these are just intellectual trends or artistic modes. If I can impress one thing on you, it's that you see these schools as fun. Yes, some of it's pretentious, and I'm not saying I agree with all of it either, but do try to see the sense of play or enjoyment in these movements. I hope I've at least made it less scary and that you've enjoyed this video.